Ashley Brazil. I am here with BB&T Bank. I currently manage the Bessemer and the Pleasant Grove offices. I have been with BB&T. November will make 8 years for me, but I've been in banking a total of 12 years. So I've got a lot of banking under my belt to be able to help my clients take care of their banking needs. My main thing to do on a regular basis is go out and provide financial wellness like I'm doing here tonight, and to go out and help our small businesses grow. Like I tell everybody, if I'm not helping my small businesses grow with my clients, I'm not doing my job, and there's no reason for me to be there. My thing is wanting to be able to see more people be financially successful, finding ways that you can put more money in your pocket each day. Just a little bit about myself. I grew up in the Birmingham area. I graduated from Minor High School. I am married with 2 children. I have an 8-year-old daughter and an 11-year-old son. So that's a little bit about me. I want to start right now on the financial wellness piece. I'm just going to choose a volunteer to go now to tell me your question that you may have about credit before we get started. I'm going to start with you in the back. Tell me what question you have about finances or credit.
Officially.
Okay.
But I work full time, so
okay.
I really don't have time to on the side to do. But I had got a loan, to fix up my little place.
Yes, ma'am.
But I paid that off. But I have to do some more work. So I guess the credit question would be trying to get another loan.
Okay. So since the business isn't officially open yet, are you looking to get something personally? Or are you looking to wait to get something in the business name?
In the business name, do you have to have, already established?
Tax returns and being on, that's a great question. A lot of people have that exact same question. Banks will work with people that are startups. There is certain criteria that they may look at. Of course, in some cases, people may not have the 2 years tax returns. But in that case, you have to have a business plan. And then you want to have some type of projection as well as far as what you project the cash flow to be for the next 3 years. So that's something that they require as well. And I also partner with a company called Lift Fund as well. Lift Fund is very big on helping our small businesses that are startups. And they're a little different from a traditional bank because what they usually look for is just checking to see if you have lates within the past 6 months on your personal credit report. And they're right out of Bessemer. So they have been a jewel for me to be able to help clients that are starting up that may not be able to get help from the bank. But I want you all to know that banks are there to help clients as well. Okay? So just to elaborate on that, since she's telling me about starting her business, I go and visit a lot of businesses on a daily basis. That's what I'm supposed to be out doing. In my office is basically in my car because I'm driving around looking, trying to see who I can find to help. I get a lot of people that have businesses, and a lot of them may get a big lump sum of money from somewhere, and they start the business. But the issue is with a lot of people is when they get this lump sum of money, they don't take care of things that may be going on personally. So therefore, they're spending all of their personal money trying to support the business, and that's not the ideal. You always want to make sure that if you need help, you're not having to always use your money, that you can go to the bank if need be. If you got it like that, that's good, but everybody doesn't have it rolling in like that. And I see so many businesses go out of business simply because they're supported on their own money, which is tough. Because you may have times that come around where you got employees that may need to be paid. They're looking, trying to see, I didn't make ends meet. What am I going to do to pay my employees? And that's what a lot of people look at trying to get business lines of credit for that particular reason. Does anybody here know what a business line of credit is? Let me ask you that question. Anybody can take a guess? We all in here learning together. So anybody take a guess? Just shout something out.
It's a line of credit that's attached to your checking account to cover anything that you might need when you're short.
Mm-hmm. It could be one of them. Just say business lines of credit. Just say we're talking $50,000. I've got a business. only pull off that line of credit as I need to. So I'm only paying interest on the amount that I pulled off. So if I've only pulled off $10,000, I'm going to only pay $10,000 interest on that $10,000 versus the full $50,000 line that I have. Does that make sense? So you're not paying an installment loan on $50,000. You're only paying the interest on that $10,000. So those can be very supportive for businesses to have for working capital because, believe it or not, just about every business that I've gone to, they have slow periods. And the one that tripped me out the most was when I heard a funeral home had slow periods during the year. But funeral homes even have slow periods. And they even have lines of credit for working capital. So something that I want to see, especially in our Black communities, I see a lack where a lot of people don't understand how credit works. And that's my goal, to make sure that I'm going out and talking to everybody, making them more knowledgeable about what we can do so it's not we're having to go to a payday loan place when Christmas time comes or when I need tires. A recent study that was done on one of the news websites stated that 35% of Americans didn't even have money and savings to afford a brand new pair of tires if they needed. You know, and that's a lot of people. That's a lot of people, and we've got to find ways to be able to cope with that and take care of that. So let me ask you all this question. How many of us in here have credit cards? Okay. So, Ms. Brenda, I'm going to use you an example. Okay. If you've got a $2,000 line on your credit card, what should the balance never go over so that it doesn't report negatively on your credit? You are exactly right. Do you know a lot of people don't know that? They think that just because they have a $2,000 credit card, as long as they're making monthly payments, the minimum at that, they think that that's good. On-time payments are good, but a lot of people don't know. Once you go over half of what that actual line is, it drops your credit so quick. It drops your credit quicker than an installment loan. I tell people all the time, credit cards can really help you or they can really harm you. And for people that are looking to build credit, I usually talk to them about secured credit cards, but I make sure I sit them down and I coach them and let them know. Most of the time we start them off on like a $400 secured credit card, and I let them know, don't ever let the balance go over $200. You're mainly want to use it for gas and fast food, something that you can pay off real quick and it's reported to the bureaus. To give you a prime example, I had a client that came to me, and I'm in the church, of course, I would not be making this up anyway. She came to me in April of 2016. This lady, she had no credit whatsoever. And I said, let's get you a secure credit card, because I said, if you go somewhere and make a purchase, I said, sometimes having no credit is just as bad as having bad credit. I said, let's go ahead and get your credit started. So we got her a $500 secure credit card. She came back and saw me in October. And we were able to get her a $7,500 unsecured credit card. She got her deposit back off of that secured credit card, and her credit score was 750. 6 months. 6 months is all that it takes, but it begins with knowledge on how to use those cards. Can somebody else in here tell me something that a lot of people may not know what can hurt your credit outside of using the credit cards?
Paying late.
Somebody throw out a guess and tell me how many points a late payment can take you down. You've been quiet, sir. Throw out a guess. Tell me. Just guess. It's not. Come on, just guess.
20%.
You think 20 points?
20 points.
Go up.
About 70.
It can take you down anywhere from 30 to 40 points. One late payment. I tell people all the time, even if it's just you making the minimum payment, make the minimum payment, because a late payment will take you down 30 to 40 points. I have seen it happen. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, like one day.
So let me ask you this question. On an installment loan or on a credit card? Because I'm going to tell you what the difference comes in.
I guess
credit cards. Usually with credit cards, they are reported late and they give you a late fee that next day. Installment loans, you all know that's something that's a car loan, anything that's not revolving a mortgage, anything like that. They'll usually give you a grace period. But when does it report to the credit bureau? Does anybody know that you got a late payment once it takes a detrimental drop on your when it reports on your credit bureau report when it's 30 days or more past due. So I tell people, if you can't afford to pay more, at least make the minimum monthly payment, because that's very important to do that. And I tell people in a minute, a credit card will hurt you worse than an installment loan. And they're not for everybody, because some people will tell you up front they don't have any control with credit cards. And I'm okay with that, because at least you know, and you know we're not going to give you one to go out here and get in debt. But I tell people, if you know that you can't, you know, you don't have self-control with it, we can look for other ways to try to build your credit. But a credit card is one of the quickest ways to build your credit, okay?
Well, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Just say you have one credit card. Now, we know that $1,000 is about the max you need to put on the credit card. You got $2,000 on there.
Yes, ma'am.
Let's say you only have that one credit card, and you go up to, let's say, $1,800. Would that hurt you?
Oh, you mean,
if the first loan are paid off?
So you're saying that you're going over the limit, $800 on a one? I'm sorry, you said, okay, we got a $2,000 credit card, and you go up to $1,800.
Yeah.
Okay, so before I answer that, does anybody want to give a shot at what the answer is?
But if you pay the rest, you got to be able to pay the rest of them off. You got about five of them, so you pay four off, and you went to $1,800 on that one.
Okay. Are you going to be paying that one off before your statement ends?
No.
Okay. So the answer to that question is, if you're not going to be paying that card off before the statement cycle ends, it's going to hurt you. And the reason being is because you're close to maxing the card out. You don't have much available credit. So that's, let me say this. We do have some people that will go to the max on the card, but they pay it off at the end of the month before the statement cycle ends. Now, when you do that, that doesn't hurt you, because you want to make sure that that card is below half of what the limit is when that statement cycle drops, because that's reporting to the creditors that you know how to use your credit maturely, and you're not overexerting yourself on the available credit that you have. Okay? Okay. So, I'm going to take another volunteer. Anybody want to raise their hand on their question, or I'm going to call on somebody? Okay, Miss Lady in the Green, tell me what question you have about credit or finance.
Well, I'm actually working on my credit right now.
Okay.
I budget, but I get too much.
Okay.
And so then I have a grace period when I just like, okay, that's enough.
Okay.
But then I have all these inquirers that with this is too much, and it drops your scores down.
You are absolutely right. Absolutely right. Everybody is aware that anytime a creditor pulls your credit report for the purpose of getting a loan, credit card, etc., everybody is aware that that does drop your credit score 2 to 3 points every time it's done, correct? And when lenders see that, they look at you as being high risk because they see that you're out trying to get credit from somebody. So be cautious of that. I always tell people to shop around before they actually have somebody to run their credit. And something that's very important, a lot of people don't know this, when you go out to buy a car, a lot of people don't know when you go to these dealerships, they use several different lenders. And anytime that they put your application in, it's going through several different people. So that could be 7 to 8 hits at one time. A lot of people don't know that. So I tell people, if you're going to buy a car, go into a branch. Go into a branch and see if that bank can approve you first, because versus you having one hit on your credit, you go to that dealership, you're going to have about 7 or 8. And you know it, because when you get home a week later or so, you're going to be getting all these in the mail saying that if you were approved or denied. Those people have hit your credit for the purpose of you getting a loan. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I have a situation. My daughter.
Okay.
So, having a co-sign loan. So I told her, I'm getting ready to get me a house. I don't want, you know, nothing messed up by me doing all this co-signing for her loans. Because,
mm-hmm.
you know, when it comes time for, you know, me to get my house, I want to be able to ease right on through it.
Yes, ma'am.
So would that hurt, you know, keep co-signing?
Yes, ma'am, because they're looking at your credit as well. And a lot of people get a co-signer because that person usually has a stronger credit score. So that's, they're looking at your credit as well anytime that you go and co-sign on any type of vehicle. Yes, ma'am. Vehicle, credit card, if somebody puts you as an authorized user on their credit card, and this is something I see all the time, I will, this is one a lot of people don't know anything about. Just say, me and you, Ms. Richardson, had a credit card together. And you just added me on the credit card. And I go and use the credit card and I don't pay it. That's gonna go on your credit card. That's gonna go on your credit as well. It's gonna go on there as a late payment, and if it gets charged off, it's gonna reflect on both of us. And a lot of people don't know that. And I'm gonna tell you all something too. Be careful about going, getting on people's checking accounts too. I can't make this up. I had a lady come in the bank and had a fit with me because she had gotten on the account with, I think, a cousin or a friend. It was one of the two. And the young lady had overdrawn her checking account. Well, in the bank services agreement, and that's with every bank, there is something called a right to offset. And a right to offset basically means if you have any other account and it has your name on it, the bank can go in there and pull that money out to cover that overdrawn balance on that other account. We see that all the time where a lot of people, they get their paperwork and they don't read through it, but this is something that happens more common than you know. And I tell people, be cautious about anything that's got your name on it, because if it's somebody else's and they're not taking care of it, it's going to go against you as well. So be cautious about that. Okay? Yes, ma'am. Let me say this, different banks have different rules. I have worked at Wells Fargo in the past, and with Wells Fargo, I think both people had to be there, if I recall correctly. With BB&T, how we operate is, if you and I are on the account together, Ms. Richardson, I could come in and close the account out. I don't have to have you with me. But we can't take somebody off of an account unless they're deceased. It'll have to be closed out. So you, that may be that bank's policy. I know different banks do have different policies as far as how they operate, but I know with Wells Fargo, you can take somebody off, but both parties have to be there. So that's why I tell people, be careful and know what you're getting into when stuff like that happens, because if that person decides they want to go out here and have a shopping spree on a zero balance, you better believe it's going to go against your credit as well once it gets charged off to collections, okay? Okay, and I know you told me about budgeting. I want to talk about savings, and I'm going to get back to some other questions as well. How many of us can say that we have money saved back for a rainy day in case something happens? And it's okay if you don't raise your hand. That's good. That's good. I want to talk about savings because, believe it or not, I do a lot of these presentations, and a lot of people tell me that they can't save or they don't know how to save. Do we have people in here that may feel the same way? Is if they can't save or they don't know how to save? It's okay. We being honest, talking amongst each other. What about don't want to save? Okay.
Sometimes it's not having anything to save, though. But then I'm learning that you can take a dollar or $2 and put it to the side.
That's right. That's so true. And this is what I tell people. You have to start with what's easy for you to manage. It may not be easy for you to do $50 a paycheck. It may not be easy for you to even do $25 a paycheck, depending on your situation. But I tell everybody, think about something that you do every week that's constant. You know that you do this every week. Believe it or not, most people tell me they're either going to Starbucks in the morning or they're either going out for lunch at some point during the week. And most of them say it's every day. So it can be something as simple as, instead of going out to lunch, put those $5 back in a savings account 2 to 3 times a week. It's okay to eat out sometime. It's okay to treat yourself. But at the same time, think about about this government shutdown they just had and how many people were affected by that are living paycheck to paycheck. Do you all know how many lives could have been changed if some people just had a little savings? Just a little savings. So I challenge you all, take a look at what you're spending every week. And I'm so glad to hear that you're saying you're budgeting, because if you look back at some stuff, you'll say, oh my God, I really spent that amount toward this, and it makes a difference. And I'll be honest, I'll be the first to tell you, I had to stop, because every time I was going to the grocery store, I was spending enough money to pay another bill. And when I went back and looked, I said, oh my God, I said, I have got to do something about this, because this is ridiculous. So you know what I did? If you really want to start doing something and you put your mind to it, you can do it. It doesn't matter what it is. When I found out about the Walmart app, where you can go and pick, have your groceries picked up, I started doing that because it helped me keep a total at the top of how much I was spending. So I know it ain't no surprises when I get to the register, because I can take stuff out, you know, add it as I go. So I said, if I mess up, it's on me. And when I tell you, that has helped me out so much, because I sit up and said, there's no way I should be going to the grocery store each month spending this amount of money on groceries. And I sit up, and ever since I've done that, I have been successful. So when I tell you, if it's something that you want to do, regardless if it's dealing with budgeting or something in life in general, pray about it and put your mind to it, and it'll come to pass. Okay? On the end, I had everybody to come up with a question about finance or credit that you wanted to ask. Can you tell me a question that you may have about credit or finance that you'd like me to answer for you? Not right now. I'll come back to you. Yes, ma'am.
You're talking about banks. What about credit unions? Do they have the same?
As far as
policies?
Credit unions are kind of different from banks. We do have some similarities as far as some of the federal guidelines that we follow. Now, as far as adding people to the accounts and taking them off, I'm not sure. I do know we follow some of the same federal guidelines, though. But I'm pretty sure, I don't want to say I'm 100% sure, they probably have something in place where if you're on an account with somebody and it's left negative for so long, they can take that money from another account. Okay?
What if you, like a payee for somebody?
Like a representative payee?
Representative payee for someone with Social Security.
Well, let me ask you that question. So, if you're a representative payee for somebody, that person that's the actual beneficiary, they should be going and taking money out of that account, right?
They can.
Right.
So, the thing is this, if I want to close it out, I can just close it out.
That is correct.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Because the other person, you're basically their representative taking care of everything for them. They wouldn't be able to come and transact any type of business on the account.
Right.
You would have to be there to do it.
Right.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Anybody have any questions about representative payee accounts at all, or what they may be? Yes, ma'am.
Is it associated with Social Security check?
Yes, it could be Social Security check. We get a lot of kids that get those checks as well, where the account has to read, just say, we're just going to use me and Ms. Richardson, for example. The account could read Brenda Richardson, representative payee for Ashley Brazil. Ms. Richardson would be the only person that could come in there and take care of anything on the account. I wouldn't be able to do anything because she's my representative. And we have to have a letter coming from Social Security that states that you're that person's representative payee in order for us to set those type of accounts up. We usually see those with a lot of kids or a lot of adults that may have, they just can't take care of their business on their own. It may be, they may have some type of mental disorder or something like that. We would take care of, the representative payee would take care of that for them. Okay? Any other questions about that?
Well, I'm kind of dealing with something on that line.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a daughter that gets Social Security from her dad.
Yes, ma'am.
So the way he's handling the money, I think it's not fair. I know he have to give an account, like they have to tell how the money is being used.
Yes, ma'am.
So I just, I was, let me see how to say this. Well, he gives her, you know, tax. And he gives her some of the money, but He mostly uses it himself.
Oh, we see a lot of those cases
and then
too.
And he would say that, you know,
yeah,
well,
you're not supposed
you're
to
supposed
do
to,
it.
Supposed he to said, well, you're supposed to help for, you know, the house. But
right.
She don't pay the whole bills.
So what you may want to do, is he her actual guardian?
Yes.
What you may want to do, is she with you at all?
Yeah.
So what you may want to do is go down to the Social Security office, and you are aware it is one here in Bessemer. It's down there by Nissan and Cracker Barrel. It's back behind that way. And you can explain to them what's going on, and they'll investigate it. And if that's the case, what they'll do is see about reassigning those benefits to have somebody else be the representative payee.
Right.
We see that a lot. It happens a lot.
He said he worked for that money.
Wow. I'm not surprised. We see this happen. We see it a lot. Especially when a death occurs. Yeah, a death occurs. You wouldn't believe some of the things that we see. And since we're talking about this, let me go ahead and go over this. We are seeing so many cases where somebody is on a checking account by themselves and they pass away unexpectedly. Nobody in the family is expecting. They don't have another owner on the account at all. Can anybody guess what happens in cases like that?
They use the check.
Well, in some situations, we've seen people illegally use the money, but it's hurtful to the family because sometimes those funds are needed for the funerals.
Right.
They're needed for the funerals, and we can't give anybody money that's not listed on that account. So therefore, a lot of times they have to go through probate court. They have to go through probate court to get those funds out, or you'll have to go and get another form for the court. And that's something that's not immediate. It can take weeks and months to get that taken care of.
But that's a catch-22, because just earlier you said if you got somebody on your account and they mess your money up, then you can be in a situation, because family can do to you just as friends can do
exactly.
to you. So you could be caught. That's a catch-22.
Tell me what you say is a catch-22 about
it. Well, if somebody's on my account and I got them on my account because if something happens to me, then they may need the money for my funeral.
Right.
But if the person that's on my account with me is a fool and go mess up my money, then I still don't have no money for my funeral.
And I'll be honest with you. Let me be honest with you. It happens. I'm going to be honest with you. That's why I tell people, and I listen to a lot of people when they come through, and make sure it's somebody you trust. But there is an ultimate ending to that.
Mm.
Have you all ever heard of putting somebody on an account as payable on death?
That's what I was going to say. So it's payable upon death.
You can do that as well, because we get a lot of people that come in the bank that say, I don't want somebody being a joint owner, because a joint owner is going to have just as much right as you to come in there and take money out of that account. But if I put somebody on the account as payable on death, let's just say it's Ashley Brazil, payable on death to Brenda Richardson. Let's just say I pass away. All Ms. Richardson would have to do is come into the bank with my death certificate. And we would cut her an official check for the funds that are in that account. Just that simple. You're not having to go to probate court, because a lot of people don't know when you have to go through the probate court, that costs money. And it is not a day thing. Like I said, it can take weeks to months to be able to get that stuff settled.
That is so important. I'm so glad you told me that.
Yes. That's why I tell, because I get people all the time where they come and tell us, I don't want to put that person as a joint owner, and I said we got the payable on death option. Because I'm going to be honest with you all, and this is not to scare anybody, it's just let people be alert. Most of the time when we have elderly people come in the bank and they tell us they have fraud on the account, most of the time we look no further than who's in the house with them. Because 90% of the time it's somebody that's living right there in the house with them. And I'm going to say this, and this is not, it's true. I've been in banking 12 years. As long as I've been in banking and seen a lot of fraud, there have been a lot of cases of fraud that I've seen. I've only seen two cases where the people actually press charges. And most of the time, when you don't press charges, a lot of time you can't get your money back from the bank. And the second time just came up less than a month ago, where she actually pressed charges against her daughter. But a lot of times they won't press charges against them. So be cautious about who you haven't added to your account. And be cautious about leaving stuff around, regardless. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
What you're talking about, my mom went through the same thing. like, when her husband passed away, what happened was they when they started, they was banking at Regions for years, for like 27 years. And my mom had, her house was like almost $400,000. She got this big old house, 8 bedrooms, 6 bathrooms. Well, what happened was he died for her. So when they first got married, they had a joint account. Mm-hmm. Well, what he did was he snuck behind her back and got his own separate account. And he thought that she was gonna pass before him. So he had everything set. It was crazy. We went through so much emotional. My mom went through so much of that. And we went to Regions trying to get the money. What he was doing, he was saving his money and using my mom's money. And so he had built up so much money for himself. My mom did not find out none of this stuff until he died. So when we went to the Regions Bank, it might have been here in Bessemer, because we went on, she had to go to probate court. They went and released the money. He had took her name off the account. She still thought she was on his account. Well, what happened was they told her she couldn't get none of his money.
Yeah, because if she's not on it, we can't just release those funds. We have to have those court-ordered documents to be able to do anything. You know, and a lot of times we have to set up an estate account, you know, for those funds to go into, because, you know, usually it'll take up to 6 months for the estate to be settled. You know, so that's why I tell people, any one of us in here today could walk out of this church today and not make it home. Have somebody that you trust on an account or is payable on death. Because we have seen so many families that have gone through that where the person has just passed unexpectedly. I went through it last year because I had an uncle that I was close to pass unexpectedly last year. And luckily, my mom knew what his insurance policies was and whatnot. But as far as getting accounts settled, it took a while because she had to go and get that form from the courthouse.
Yeah, that's what she did. She had to go to Michigan. He died in Detroit, but she went through so much, like even for his VA, the check for the VA, she had to go through. They went and released the money. She had to get another attorney. Then she had to get another probate. I mean, it was just, she had to get attorney after attorney because he was so secretive.
Yeah, and I'm going to tell you all something too. A lot of people don't know. A lot of people, when somebody passes away and they see that Social Security coming in, they try to use that Social Security money. I'm going to tell you something like this. Social Security, usually when somebody passes away, they come and take that money right back depending on the day of the month that they passed away. And the thing about it is, if you're due the money, they'll send you a check. They'll send you the check. But they'll come and take that money back out of the account depending on the day that the person passed away. So be cautious about that if you're on an account with somebody and you're planning on using that money, because Social Security will come and take that money back. And a lot of people don't know the funeral home alerts Social Security when this stuff happens, because we get a lot of people think that they finna be secretive and take this money out, and Social Security don't know. The funeral homes alert Social Security when people pass away. Yes, ma'am.
And they only is, see why they want to keep it low, it's just $255 unless they don't win up about that. That happened with me with my mom. All I did, you don't have to, you can alert, calm yourself, you just turn the check back in.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the end of that.
Yeah. There's a lot of people that think that, you know, those funds belong to them. But like I said, it's a time frame depending on when that person passes away. If you pass that time frame, Social Security is coming back to take their money. And I tell people, check with your loved ones to make sure they have life insurance. Does anybody here know the amount that it costs just average to bury somebody? I just want somebody to just take a guess.
$10,000.
Yes, ma'am. When we buried my uncle last year, just a basic funeral, it was, I think, including his plot and everything, it was almost $10,000. That's a lot to leave on a family that's living the paycheck to paycheck. Was just somebody just having to come out of pocket $10,000. That's a lot of money. Check with your loved ones. I had one of my friends that works for the same company I do. She had a client that come in her office, and I think they were like 105 years old and had passed away and didn't have life insurance. And that was left on her daughter. And I tell people, I would rather pay that few dollars a month than to have to come out of pocket wondering what I'm going to do to bury my loved one. These are questions that need to be talked about.
Yeah,
because I deal with a lot of funeral homes on a very frequent mean, and it's business. It's business. You know, they're like, it's nothing that I can do, especially if you don't have any funds. So check with your loved ones. It doesn't matter the age, even these children. We all saw the tornado that came through last week and several people lost their lives. Make sure you have life insurance and check with your loved ones and make sure they have life insurance, because that's a big burden to leave on the family. Okay? I'm going to take your question in the red shirt that you may have about credit or finance.
I don't think I have any. I think I spoke when I was talking about, I was really interested about what do you do with somebody on your account, which I didn't know, which is about that payable upon death. I don't think I have any other question.
Okay. You got yours, Rick? Okay.
How did you go about if your credit got bad?
Okay. First off, have you reached out? First off, let me say, because you could just be asking a general question. I always tell people, reach out to whoever the creditor is that's on your credit report that's reporting negatively. Because you want to see, before I even go there, if a repossession occurs, does anybody know what usually happens after the repossession occurs as far as what the lender does? Okay. What the lender normally does is they try to go and sell the car at auction and try and get the most that they can off of it. And a lot of people don't know, most of the time you're only held responsible for what amount they did get from the auction that you owed. So if you may have owed $14,000 and they got $10,000 at the auction, they're looking for you to, in most cases, pay $4,000. Okay, and I'm gonna say in most cases because it could differ. Reach out to these people, because I run into a lot of people that have items on their credit report just thinking if they just let it sit there, it's going to magically disappear, and it's going to magically disappear into a judgment. That's what it's going to do. So what you want to do is call these people, because a lot of people will take a minimum of $5 a month as long as you're paying them something. But the goal is to get it on your credit report as an improved account. And if you're making payments, that's what it's going to show as. But as long as you're letting it sit there, it's not helping you at all. Make some type of payment. And does everybody in here know where you can go and get a free credit report a free credit report from every year? And it'll give you all three bureaus.
FreeCreditReport.com?
No, ma'am.
What?
It was a good try, though. AnnualCreditReport.com. Everybody, please write that down. Put it in your phone. They will give you all of your credit reports from all three bureaus. Does everybody know why it's important to look at all three bureaus?
Well, they have different scores. And sometimes this credit bureau may have a negative on you, whereas the other one doesn't.
Exactly.
And you can call them and get that negative cleared up, and then kind of fix your own credit.
Mm-hmm. That is so true. Everybody does not use the same credit bureaus when it comes to report. So Experian may have something showing that TransUnion may not show it, so your TransUnion score may actually be higher than Experian. So I tell people, when you go to annualcreditreport.com, pull those reports at different times of the year, simply because you want to see what's been updated and what's still there. And if you see something that doesn't add up, dispute it. Don't let it just sit there. Don't let it just sit there. Go on there and dispute it. And most of the time, when you have your records that something has been paid or that you're paying on an item, they'll delete it and they'll cause your credit score to go up. That's the end result for your score to go up. So call these people and follow up with them. That is very important. Don't just let it sit there, because that's just like I talk to people all the time and try and help them be able to raise their credit. And I'm like, have you called this person? No. It's not helping you. Okay? Something else I want to talk about too is home ownership. I love to see more people get homes than renting if that's what's for you. And the reason that I said if that's what's for you, because somebody that may not need a home is somebody that may not afford to be able to keep up a yard. They may not be able to keep up general expenses in the house. You know, a new roof, that's expensive. So renting may be good for somebody that just wants to stay in an apartment and have somebody with maintenance fix on things. Let me ask you all this question. Do you all know what most companies require as a minimum credit score to get a home?
I think it's
6.20.
Oh, 20.
Uh-huh. And there are some lenders that will go lower than that, but with most of them, it's 6.20 or better. The higher your credit score is, the better chance of you getting a lower rate. And I tell people, anytime that you're looking to get a home, be cautious of what you're doing in your checking account. And when I say be cautious, because anything that you deposit in that account, and if it's more than $200 and it's cash, you're going to have to go through your entire statement and explain where that money came from and show proof. They are very particular about this, so be cautious about just putting cash in there if you don't have some type of paper trail to show where you got that check from. I'm sorry, that cash from. If you cash the check and put it in as cash, make a copy of that check and make sure that the amount adds up, because they're going to want to see that. Okay, and when you're going through the process to get a house, they ask anywhere from 6 to 12 months bank statements. I hear so many people saying, "Oh, I don't have a checking account. I don't do this. I don't do that." How do you think you're gonna go about getting a house without having a checking account? Those days are over where you can just go and pay cash for a house because of so many people money laundering. So they want to see some type of records of what you're doing to be able to get that money. You can't just go and show up with $85,000 in your checking account. Don't think they're going to ask where it come from. They're going to want to know where it came from. And if you can't show them where it came from, it's a done deal in most cases. Okay? A lot of people, yes, sir.
Do they do athletes like that too? Like football players, basketball players, baseball players like that?
Yeah. And you know the reason why? A lot of times, athletes, they have personal accountants that take care of this stuff for them. You know, and they have bank accounts that they're managing for them. So it's nothing for them to get their accountant to say, "Hey, can you pull those statements for me to send to XYZ bank for me to get this house?" They go through the same process. You can buy, now let me say this, you can buy a house with cash money, but they're going to still ask for your bank statements to make sure that their money been sitting there or that you get gift funds from somebody else. Does anybody here know what gift funds are? Okay. Gift funds would be where, just say Ms. Richardson wanted to write me a check to go toward me buying my home. At that point, they're going to get a check, they're going to get a copy of the check, and they're going to maybe want to ask to see Ms. Richardson's bank statement to make sure she's got adequate funds to cover what she's given me and that this has been ongoing in her checking account. A lot of people don't know that they think that they can just get money from somebody and put in their account. No. There's stipulations that come along with that, and you have to be cautious about that. Yes, ma'am.
Is there a difference between, because I don't fool with banks anymore, I just don't, because they have wiped my brother out. Like, he got so much money stolen from him out of his bank account, and they made him pay it back, and he's not even the one that even stole the money out of his bank. So I am going different. I'm going to a credit union. So I want to know is, like, you can still buy a house through a credit union?
Yeah, you can. But a credit union and a bank, I mean, there are differences in them, but you do still have a bank account then. It's just with a credit union.
Right.
Yeah, it's nothing different because, I mean, people can still bank. I'm just talking about somebody that's just using mattress money. Because we got a lot of people that still think mattress money going to work for them. But it don't. But in your case, you still have a checking account. It's just with a credit union. So you're fine.
Okay. But it's different. I don't mess with banks because they charge too much interest for me. It's just, I can watch my own money. I don't need you to, every time I swipe, you charging me to use the card with my money. And I have a problem with that.
Let me ask you this question. Are you going to an ATM, you swiping your card? Like, just say for instance, you bank with BB&T. Are you going to, like, a Wells Fargo to pull money out? Is that where they were charging you money?
Yeah, I go to Regions because they give you more. Like, instead of giving you $500, you know, they give you $1,000 or $800.
So you were getting fees because you went to another bank's ATM. Am I understanding right? Like, you had a BB&T card, but you decided to go to Regions and use the ATM, am I right? Is that the example that you're giving me? I want to make sure I answer correctly.
I'm confused now. Wait a minute. I when I swipe my card, they charge me. I never necessarily just go to the same bank.
So even when you're going to make a purchase, you're saying you were being charged to use your card. Now let me be the one to say I've never heard of it before, so I don't know what many people wouldn't have a bank account if that was the case, because I'm gonna be honest with you, I'm not fixing to pay you to swipe and use my money.
Are you saying you swipe your card for the same bank that you, at the same ATM that you have the account with?
Well, my bank is through Chase. So I don't know if it's, I mean, it might be a Chase in Birmingham, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But
there are no Chase in Birmingham. Mm-mm.
Okay.
So the only way, the only way I could see you being charged is if you're going to use your Chase card at like a Regions ATM, because most banks, and I don't know any that doesn't, they'll charge you a fee for using another bank's ATM. That's the only way I could see you being charged. Now, just going to make a purchase somewhere and you being charged, that's new to me. I hadn't heard that one, because it'll be a lot of people that wouldn't be using banks if that was the case. And I'll be honest with you, I would be the first, because that money adds up. Every little cent adds up. So I tell people, and even with the case that you said about your brother, with BB&T, anytime somebody comes into the bank and says, money was taken out of my account and this is a transaction I did not do, we file a fraud claim and it's investigated. And the fraud team actually goes in and sees if this is something that was actually done on your behalf. And if they get enough information together to see it wasn't something done on your behalf, you're going to get that money back plus any fees that you receive due to that fee coming out of your account. So it's not something that's an overnight process, but we're not going to hold you accountable for something that you did not do, and we find out that it's something that you did not do. So that's one thing. Our clients come first, and most banks, they do that as well, not just BB&T, but I'm not sure what happened in that situation, and I don't want to speak on it because I don't have all the details. But I try to tell people, if you're something that's coming out of your account, don't just let it sit there, because I get people, oh, it's been coming out for the last 3 or 4 months, and you're just not coming in the bank about it. You know, if you see something strange that's coming out of your account, go to the bank. That's what the bankers say. They have a job to do. You know, so that way we can stop that, because regardless of if it's $4.99, a lot of people have these Xbox charges, and iTunes is another one. And if you know you didn't do it, go into the bank and see about it. Don't just let it sit there and continue to go on, because if it is fraud, I'm going to be honest with you, what most people do is they'll try a small amount first. Mm-hmm. And if they see that they can get away with that small amount, they'll keep going trying until they get larger amounts. And so many people, I highly encourage you all, when you get these bank statements, even if you get them online, go through them. Because a lot of people miss fraud going on their account because they don't check their statements. I check my account at least once to twice a day. So if something is coming out of my account, I'm going to know right then so I can stop it right then before anything comes out, anything else comes out for that matter. Okay? Ms. Richardson, I met you. Tell me what question you have. Is when the equity in your home is used to be able for you to have a line of credit. A lot of people use home equity lines of credit for home improvement. Some people may be trying to consolidate debt. And let me see if anybody can take a guess. Why do you think most people like using home equity lines of credit versus an unsecured loan? Exactly. Home equity lines of credit have lower interest rates because it's secured by collateral, which is the home. If you were to go into a bank and just do a signature loan where they're just basing it off your credit and debt to income, that's unsecured. You have no collateral. They're securing that loan, so you're going to pay a higher rate of interest. Okay? But home equity lines of credit, how BB&T works, we will loan you up to 80% of the home's value minus what you owe. So let's just say you have a $250,000 house, and you owe, let's just say, $100,000 on it, but the home is worth $250,000. So, of course, we're going to take away that $100,000, so we're going to loan you up to, because you owe the $100,000, so we can loan you up to 80% of the $150,000. Does everybody understand that example I just gave?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody, okay, we're on the same page? That's how the home equity line is a credit work. And we have them anywhere from 5, 10, 15, 20 years that you can anywhere from 5 to 20 years. Okay?
Well, my next question is, if you get ready to sell a house before you pay the home equity line of credit, how does that work?
A lot of people so that the house can be sold, as well as that line of credit paid for. Okay? Very good options to have if that's something that you're interested in, simply because of the lower rate of interest, and you only pull off of it as you need it. Just as we were talking about the business lines of credit, the home equity lines of credit work the same way. So, like I was saying, if we had a $100,000 home equity line of credit, you know, if you need to pull off $10,000, you're only going to pay interest on that $10,000. Okay, very good to have in lower rates of interest, and usually those right now are running anywhere between the 4% and 5% range. Okay, something else I want to talk about since we're talking about credit, because I think I've gotten a question from everybody. Does everybody know what's being looked at anytime that you go and apply for anything that's dealing with any type of loan? Does everybody know what they're looking at? I know everybody know one thing.
Isn't that the history of
credit and debt to income is what's being looked at anytime that you apply for any type of loan. Does everybody here know what debt to income is? Okay. Debt to income is basically looking at the amount that you're paying out, your debts, versus your income. So if you got a lot of debts that you're having to pay and you don't have the income to be able to satisfy those debts, that's going to cause your debt to income to be high. The lower your debt to income and the better your credit, the better rates, the better odds of you having that loan approved. Okay? Want to make sure that you're keeping your debts low, that you're not getting overloaded with the debts that you have coming in. Because it can happen with a lot of people. We've seen people with great credit scores but have high debt to income, and therefore the loan won't go through. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So do we need credit?
Yes.
Let me tell you, yeah.
Yes. I'm going to tell you, so many people ask that same question. Like I was telling people, when you go somewhere, you can pay a high interest rate, just like somebody that doesn't have good credit, because they don't have anything to go on your history as far as what type of rate they're going to give you. So in most cases, you're going to get the higher interest rate.
Can I ask you a biblical question?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you think we've gotten into this system to the point where now we have to have credit? And we can't, because this church, we profess that we're debt-free. And at what you're talking about, we can't be debt-free.
Oh, I'm not saying that, so let me correct it.
What you saying?
Let me say this.
I'm just saying. Tell me. Work with me.
Okay, like I was telling everybody about the credit cards.
Yes.
What was the main thing that I said about the credit cards, if you want to go back to what I said earlier?
You got to be able to pay them off.
Exactly. So if you're paying the credit card off, you're not having any debt.
Yes, but I'm stuck in the system of the 666. I'm the conspiracy person.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm being biblical now.
Right.
But I'm gonna stop messing with you. Gonna finish your speech.
No, that's what I'm here for. That's what I'm here for. But I'm glad you asked me that. You know, a lot of people come in and want to know that. And that's why I tell people, listen to what I said. You want to get it where you can pay it off, because the goal is to be debt free. But I see so many people that feel as if they have cash and they don't have to have credit. But the thing about it is, anytime that you go to get something,
the world works on credit.
They want to look at they want to know. They want to pull your credit and look at it. You can have all the cash in the world, you know, but the thing about it is that cash can't supplement your credit history.
Since you work with all these people, all the rich, rich, rich folk, they have to have credit too, or can they just buy?
They can buy it if they want to use their cash, but do you think that everybody is going to use their cash that they have all the time?
No.
No,
they're not.
No, I'm here to tell you, no, they're not.
I'm just asking. I don't know.
No, I'm telling you, they're not.
They're not.
I deal with a vast variety of people each day that I go to work, and I can tell you right now, a lot of people, because the thing is, they don't want us to continue to have the, you know, you may have $100,000 just sitting, but who's to say if you wanted a $40,000 car, you wanted to use that $100,000 to go and purchase that $40,000 car? Because what if something could come up? I'm just being honest.
Something like the car came up? Or you mean something else
up? Say you spent that $40,000 out of that
$100,000
and something came up where you needed a large amount of money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but something's always coming up. I mean, I'm just saying.
You
if you,
my point, though. You understand
yeah,
what I'm saying?
Yeah, but the car came up, and then after you bought the car, something else came
right.
up. If you didn't buy the car, something else going to come up anyway. I mean, if you're a Christian, something coming up, I'm telling you. The next wave coming.
Things do come up, and that's the whole point of you not want to always use your money like that. Some people are doing finance stuff so that they're not having to always use that money that's sitting back in reserve.
Okay, my lesson is taught that this is becomes a heart issue. You don't need no car. You don't need no more clothes. You don't need no nails, and you don't need no... all this stuff, you just don't need none of it. So you can just, you know, just,
I'm,
I guess,
I'm
leave it there.
Like I tell everybody, enjoy life, but do it maturely.
Okay.
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 Yes, ma'am.
Now, I'm one of the ones that just buy a cash out.
Okay.
But I made a decision to do that because I feel like if I buy it out, it's mine. I'm an old man. So I bought my BMW cash.
Old man, nothing but to love, though.
That's it. I bought my BMW cash. And everything else, like the oil change, which BMW is very expensive.
Yeah.
My oil change was like $90, $100 every month. And that money, I just took care of my baby. I just took care of her. But it was my car. I didn't have to answer to nobody. It had my name on it, my type. Everything was in my, and I just went in there and bought it out. Now, the car that I'm in now, a football player bought that car. And I didn't have to pay anything for it. Thank God. Glory be to God. It is mine. It got my name on it. So a lot of things I buy cash out so I don't be up under the system and be bound. I feel like I'm in bondage. If I'm constantly paying you, what's going to come in back to me?
So this is what I tell people. I'm going to tell you what I mainly use my credit cards for. Gas. And I pay it right off at the end of the month. So it's reported to the credit bureau that I'm using my credit and I'm using it maturely. And then I get cash rewards on my card. So basically, since I'm paying my card off at the end of the month, the bank is paying me to use the card because I'm not getting charged any interest. The goal is not to go out here and put large purchases on credit cards like that. You want to find something that's easy for you to pay off, like I said earlier, gas,
mm-hmm.
fast food, not going out here putting purchases that you know you can't pay off at the end of the month. I know I need gas, and I make sure that I pay it off, you know, before my statement cycle hits so the credit bureaus can see she's using that card, but she's paying it off. The goal is not to put large items on credit cards, because I'll be honest with you, most of us can't afford to pay large items off like that when we put them on our credit card. Some people can do, but the majority of citizens in America can't. They can't afford to do that, okay? So just think about that. Even if it's something for gas, have something reported in your name, because am I saying there's something wrong with you wanting to pay cash? No, but have something revolving in your name. You know, not an installment loan, but a credit card is basically something that's revolving. It's an open-ended line of credit, okay?
Okay.
So have something that's revolving, even if it's just for gas.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
No, I was going to say, you know, because we profess at church that we're debt-free, so I went down this road, and I was getting there, and then there was a funeral that I had to go to Chicago, and we couldn't rent anything because we didn't have a credit card. We had... got rid of all the credit cards,
yeah.
You know, cut them up.
She's telling the truth,
and
because you all do know that if you go to a rental car place, they want to see a
credit
card.
Yeah.
Keep one. Not a debit card. Not a debit card.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Just like Ms. Richardson said, keep
one.
You don't need several, because when you get several, your hand get the itch. Oh, I need this. I'm just telling you, I see it every day with folks. They don't have no control. I see it all the time.
I'm messing up
you
my film.
Only with Enterprise. Enterprise will do a debit.
But you're limited. You're limited. Because there's several other car places. What if it's not an Enterprise nearby?
That's what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
It's only Enterprise.
Mm-hmm.
Because she said no debit or none. Then Enterprise will take the debit, but your license, your address is on your license, got to match your utility bill.
Yeah, but when they take your debit, they will take $250 and tie it up off of your debit card. No, it's not immediate. I need that
it's
on the
like
trip.
It's
no,
like
you don't get it immediately. You get it back in
3 to 5 business days. Usually.
It's just 3 days. I've done it. I did it.
No, I'm saying I needed that on the trip, Miss Linda.
Ma'am.
I'm telling you, I needed that $250 on the trip.
But this is exactly why I tell people, keep one, but you don't need several. You know, we have done debt consolidation loans for people that have several credit cards. I've That's not what it's meant for. I tell people, use it for gas and pay it off. Show that you're using it maturely and pay it off. Don't get in over your head and you know it come time to pay that. You're like, I don't know if I can pay this, you know, pay them off. And that way you're not in bondage like you're saying. Okay. Yes, sir.
Well, you think next spin cards, you think they real good to have? Because I have had a few next spin cards come to me through the mail.
Netspend is a prepaid card. If I'm not, it's like a prepaid card. It's kind of like having a checking account, but it's a prepaid card. I tell people, because I think they do charge a monthly fee on those cards, why not see about getting a checking account? So if you ever needed those statements for the account, you would have an account, because it's just like a checking account. And a lot of people don't know you can set the checking accounts up now, because a lot of people are afraid of overdrawing checking accounts. Is everybody in here aware of the opt-in and opt-out notice that went into effect that they have to ask anytime you open an account up? The opt-in and opt-out notice, when you're going to open an account up, the banker is going to ask you, do you want to opt-in or opt-out for overdraft review? Opting in basically means at the bank's discretion, we'll pay the item and we'll charge you $36 per item that we pay. Opting out basically means if you don't have the funds there, we decline your card or return the item, okay? You can set a checking account up where if the funds are not there, the item is not gonna be paid, okay?
What about secured credit cards?
Secured credit cards are good for anybody that's looking to rebuild credit or establish credit. You may not have been here when I was telling them about the case earlier, but I had a lady that came and saw me in April of 2016. She didn't have any credit at all. And we got her a secured credit card for $500. October came, we were able to get her a $7,500 unsecured credit card, and her credit score was a 750. All from her using the card for gas and paying it off.
Yeah.
She just kept doing that. And I talk to people, because my thing is making sure that everybody is aware and have the knowledge that they need. Most of the time when we set these secured cards up for people, usually within 6 months, they qualify for the unsecured card, and you get that money back. You get that money back, but it's up to you and what you want to do to be able to make your credit as high as it can be. Does everybody in here know what the highest credit score is you can have?
850.
850. Okay? And the goal is to get there. And I tell people, as long as you take care of your credit like you need to, and it's important, talk to your kids, your nieces, nephews, people in the community about savings. Because one thing I see in the black community, a lot of us don't, that's not something that we talk about in a lot of households. And a lot of us, when we go off to college and whatnot, we miss ourselves up. I'd be the first to tell you, I was one that did it. I was one that did it. And one thing I say is, that stuff is not going to go, you'll be trying to explain where it came from when you try to go and get something, because it'll still be on your credit report. So if you have nieces, nephews, grandchildren, anybody in the neighborhood, and they get these credit card offers in the mail, tear them up. Because a college child doesn't need nothing with a credit card if they can't pay it back, or if they don't have a parent that's paying it for them. It's not going to do anything but hurt. I'm here to tell you. And I can't turn anybody away when they come in the bank and talk to them. But when I have younger kids come in, I try to talk to them. How are you going to pay this? Where are you going to get the money from to pay it? Because the thing about it is, I don't want anybody trying to offer my child something that I know is going to hurt them in the future. Because there's a lot of us 22, 23 years old coming in with credit scores like 300 or 400. Why? You shouldn't even have anything in your name, but it happens. It happens already. And that's sad. It happens. You are correct about that, Ms. Richardson. Yes, ma'am.
My identity got stolen like twice. I was in a gas station one time and had just bought a car and I left everything. I ran in there, tried to hurry up. Came back, I left my keys in the car and I was rushing. And I came back, everything was gone. My purse, my cell phone, and the whole car. So I'm looking around like, okay, I know I parked right here. Because I just went in there to park the gas, you know, go in there to gas. Anyway, they stole my identity. They took all my everything. So it's like I had to start all over again. My birth certificate was in my wallet. Everything was in my wallet. So my question is, if you had identity theft and they using your stuff and they taking this shoe, so it's messing your credit up. What do you recommend that that person do?
You need to follow up with the credit bureaus. That's the importance of everybody going to annualcreditreport.com to see what's on their credit. You go to annualcreditreport.com, pull it from all three bureaus at different times. If you see something that is on there that is not yours, dispute it right then and there. And I'm going to give you a prime example of why it's important to be checking your credit often. My uncle tried to go and get an apartment in his name, and they told him basically that they weren't able to give him the apartment because of his credit. When he pulled his credit report, they sent a little thing to him in the mail. Somebody had gotten a student loan in his name, a car, and they had gotten some type of credit cards as well. And what they do is they'll have the mailing address being different from what yours is. It may be going to a P.O. box or something like that. So you never know what's going on unless you're checking your credit. I'm not big on going to Credit Karma for credit score advice, but Credit Karma is good to have as far as getting alerts sent to you as far as when something is open in your name, because it'll send an email to you. Your a lender requested your a lender pull your credit due to, you know, whatever it may be that you were trying to get. It is so very important that you have some type of credit monitoring service. And a lot of them are free. You got Credit Karma, Credit Sesame. These things are free. And they'll alert you anytime something is open in your name or somebody has requested your credit report for the purpose of a loan. I sure do. Yes, ma'am. A home equity line.